Hello, comic fans, here's Earl Grey. Today I want to talk about a European comic, a Dutch comic to be precise, called January Jones, consisting so far at least out of 9 European albums. And each 3 of these albums are contained in one of these very beautiful hardcovers. Published in Germany, at least, by the small publisher Cult Comics. That's 3, that's 2, and that's the Integral, or collection number 1. They did a little mistake here at the site and used the wrong letters for the title, but they came up with a solution. So volume 2 has this paper sleeve so that you can put it around your volume 2 and everything looks fine on your shelf. And this shows you really that there have to be some nerds behind this publisher here who really care about their stuff. They do some mistakes, who doesn't, but they're willing to step up and do the best they can, and which is really appreciated. And they have an amazing back catalog. The stuff they published in the last couple of years is really interesting, to say the least. So check it out. Even though I would say that January Jones is their best title by far, and January Jones is my favorite Ligne Claire comic. I'm not the biggest fan of Ligne Claire, to be fair, I really like it more than even the Tintin books, the old Hergé books. And there you can say that there are more than... there is more than one Ligne Claire style. There are several waves, so to speak. The first being, of course, Hergé himself inventing that style and being the template for all the others who followed him. And there was there were guys like Just Zwarte who experimented a bit with the style. And then there is a third and fourth and whatever wave afterwards who went back maybe a bit to Hergé's original style. Fortunately, not in in terms of his problematic relationship with the Nazi regime of that time. He was an opportunist for sure, Hergé. And but it's easy from today's perspective to judge a guy from back then, so I won't do that, go that route. But but fortunately, Erik Heuvel really portrays in an even not satirical way the Nazis, but he shows them just as the douchebags they were, and that's completely enough to give you sort of realistic feel for the 30s, because the whole series of January Jones is set in the 30s before World War II. So it somehow can dwell a bit more in a silly, goofy adventure comic, even though it's clear these guys are up to no good. Erik Heuvel worked, the artist behind the series, worked for the Anne Frank House in Amsterdam as well, doing educational comics about the Holocaust and about Anne Frank's survival, or not survival, she was killed in the end by the Nazis. So you may want to check these comics out. Otherwise, I haven't found too much of Erik Heuvel and his comics. Bit the same and different as well with Martin Lodewijk. He hasn't too many titles under his belt, but he wrote a lot of the Storm comics. One of the most interesting, fantastic European comic series, at least when you talk about sci-fi comics. In the first place, of course, the sci-fi series is famous because of the art from Don Lawrence. But Martin Lodewijk has had a really a good part in the success of the series, in my opinion, because he invented the Pandavi universe. And if you're a Storm fan, then you know what I mean with that. And his stories are really, yeah. He found the visual language for this series, the right pacing and stuff, to back up the fantastic art of Don Lawrence. To stay a bit with Martin Lodewijk, here he is an cartoonist as well, or an artist as well. His most important work, so to speak, is Agent 327, 327. A more generic, to be honest with you, artist-wise, art-wise at least, generic Franco-Belgian funny comic. And I really bought this just because of the name Martin Lodewijk, and I was curious about the story here, which is okay, but I'm not too invested into getting more of the stuff here because just the art style doesn't appeal to me too much. And I found it interesting to see how Martin Lodewijk wrote the stories here. We have in these volumes always a very big bonus section in the beginning and documentation in the back. So these books here really are, in every sense of the word, well-made comics. Comic books, books about comics with comics. And what appeals to me the most here is maybe the fact that we have a lot of interviews and essays from the artist and the writer, Lodewijk and Heuvel himself. In other books, I have maybe the 13 books or Bruno. Brazil or these comics, often they just have contributions from the editors, and so, and they are the least interesting of all the parties involved in doing a comic, in my opinion. So here we have the script for a particular story, which is the horns of the Stier, the Toro, Toro. Oh, actually, I'm just out of word. The male cow. Anyhow, you can see here the script from Lodewijk. Instead of describing all the stuff, he drew it, and in this sort of mini comics style. I hope you can see it. And yeah, actually, you can publish this almost as a comic. And it's very close to what Erik Heuvel did. If you see the finished first page here of that comic. It's volume. Ah, no, this is volume 6. I'm already out of words here as well. The Tomb of the Zeppelin. And in this volume 6 here, this starts so. And here we have Martin Lodewijk's script. That's not so usual, I think, to have such a precise thing here. And they did some kind of lottery for a good cause, and the winner was included in one panel, and that's this lady here. Just a little side here, and we see here in front, that's the girl who was portrayed in this comic here. So you can see this comic has a bit of an importance in at least in the Netherlands, and but has a bit problems to reach a bigger, wider audience in bigger countries, which is a bit unfortunate. So let's go through all the 9 albums pretty quick here. In the first volume, we have a trilogy, and so you can really just take this first volume and check out if you like January Jones. Of course, each album is concluded in its own right as a unit, but the first 3 volumes build an arc holding them together, so you get really one good, maybe today you would call it a graphic novel in a way. This is album 1, Death Race to Monte Carlo. A lot of this silly action with different modes of transportation involved, and I love it a lot. Our title hero, January Jones, is an American female pilot who does races and stuff. Usually doesn't fly for the military, but is some kind of female rock star flying an airplane without doing music, if you know what I mean. So she is kind of popular, and but then a bit like it's with Tintin, crimes, she got involved in crime plots and has to solve them, and here's her connection to the FBI, I think, Agent X1, and most important, here's her sidekick, the Dutch boy Rick. So it's very usual, you almost can say generic, but the story is absolutely not generic, blending in facts that Martin Lodewijk read about the times, and he shoehorns this all the stuff here into the story without you really seeing it. It's not making you uncomfortable, so you don't have this feel, he wanted to tell me this and that as well, and maybe it's a bit too much. No, it's all a part of the scenery of all this, the story, with a pretty beautiful flat coloring, even though for whatever reason they choose to depict darker sceneries in this, okay, realistic fashion, but somehow I would have wished that they left these colors just a bit brighter and show us more of this beautiful, precise line work of Erik Heuvel. This continues to be some sort of issue in the next volumes as well. But anyhow, this is just a minor remark here. And that's the second album of the trilogy, The Skull of the Sultan. And here we have January Jones running around with the skull, who's sort of the MacGuffin for these third three albums, concluding with the treasure of King Solomon. And again, one thing that Eric Heuvel really excels and Martin Lodewijk let him do, depicting all stuff of airplanes and zeppelins, and this even gets a bit crazier in the next volume, as you will see. Here, that's De Havilland Comet, the plane of January Jones. Yeah, for this second volume, to be precise, for the Tome of the Zeppelin, they invented this kind of goofy Nazi airplane carrier with Zeppelin thing that floated in the sky. Maybe, or definitely this is the closest January Jones got to a bit to a goofy satire about the Third Reich stuff. But it's still very realistic in a way, even though somehow bit close to goofy nonsense like the Iron Sky movies or something like that. So, but the first album in the second volume here, The Script from Pinkerton, is nothing like that. This is a totally different story about the possibility maybe that Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid have survived and weren't killed somewhere in Mexico. And here we have some sort of documentation, and this is maybe the one where Martin Lodewijk's research and preparing for this comic here got very intense, maybe over the top, but I really love it, and especially all the drawings here in the beginning here. That's himself. The writer himself, and we have some reference to the movie with Paul Newman and Robert Redford. At some times, and this is a fact, a lot of the Wild West villains and sheriffs and all that, they worked for Hollywood. And this is all documented here, of particular Averell Dalton, the longest brother of the Daltons, in case you have read Lucky Luke, the presumably most stupid one of them. He seems to not so stupid. He wrote a book about the past times, about his history, an autobiography of sorts, and he worked for Hollywood as well. And I think he was even a part of one movie, and you can watch a movie with him on YouTube, I think. So that's really interesting, all the stuff that you can read here. And the story, they did out of these different ingredients with January Jones involved, is totally fluid and doesn't feel like a lesson in history, but it is a lesson in history, and that's great. For the most part, it's, of course, just an adventure comic that pulls you through the story here with amazing, beautiful, clean art, no hatching whatsoever. And that's all Ligne Claire is about. One little thing, these red cheeks here, if I had to do the coloring, I would have left these red cheeks out. But that's just my little concern. So, second album here, The Horns of the Bull. The Bull. The Horns of the Bull. So, yeah, it could be called January Jones in Spain. And this is not the Ku Klux Klan. This is another strange conspiracy group or things. This is Spain in the Franco, under the Franco regime. So, and again, our heroes take part in an important phase of the history in Spain. And still maintaining this lightheartedness of an adventure comic, even though you can see it's really not as Tintin-like lightheartedness. This is really hard stuff, and here he is really under, yeah, he will survive, of course, but that's not... There's some harsh stuff happening in this comic here, and of course enough stuff that leaves you a bit uncomfortable. And the last one, that's the one with this silly plane carrier Zeppelin stuff that I've shown you already, and a lot of other fantastical planes. And this really is a plane that flew in for real. For some photographer here, that's the Abrams P1 Explorer for one photographer, I guess, by the name of Abrams. So, yeah, you get a lot of these kind of information, but the reason to read these books, why you should read these, are the stories. Unfortunately, Martin Lodewijk haven't wrote any of the comics in the third volume, even despite of the fact that his name appears on the cover here. But Eric Heuvel... album 7 took over the writing duties as well. This is a story called Lenin's Corpse. Could have been called January Jones in Russia, in Soviet Russia. And the art is exciting as always. For an instance, you have these drawings here. This is really interesting how Eric Heuvel cleaned up his, in the beginning, rather loose pencil drawings to get these precise drawings in the panels. About this Beria guy who was... sexist douchebag of the Soviets, of the communists, who was infamous for raping women, and he tries that scheme on our hero, but not for the best, for his best, because that's here some kind of signature move here. She's not damsel in distress. She knows where it hurts most. So, I think we get here the pre-drawing for that signature move as well. It was on the cover on EPO, the Dutch comic magazine in which these comics were serialized before they could appear in the albums. And this was really important for Eric Heuvel to get money for his comics in advance and not to do a whole album without getting any money. So, and EPO hasn't survived, I think. So this is really a problem for him doing his comics, just this financial stuff. But I think when an English version will come out and people in, all in the world will read January Jones, his financial problems will be could be solved, and he can do a lot of more more comics of this way here. But I have to say that the last three volumes here, albums written by Eric Heuvel, are my least favorite, despite of all the little or not so little nudges and Easter eggs towards Tintin. For the, you will, as a Tintin fan, you will for sure recognize the sequence here, and there are a lot of Easter eggs up to the point where Tintin appears for real in one sequence. Here we have Tintin and Struppi. Is this a German name? I'm Tintin. Ah. Egal. anyhow, yeah. And this is in the second album of the third volume, and this is called The First Emperor. Yeah, yeah, you can see how Eric Heuvel sees his own work, taking the stick from Tintin. He has the pre-drawing for that particular scene I've shown you just a second before. So it's he did same amount of documentation before doing this comic here, and this is a toy based on the tank car from the Blue Lotus, this Tintin adventure, and the whole album here could be named for many reasons, just the Blue Lotus 2.0. Here we have a Brazilian actress, I think. I don't know about her nationality, but she was shot, photographed to do some advertisements for a Brazilian translation, or Portuguese translation, I think, of January Jones. So the stuff here should be available in Portuguese, coming to think of it. Which make it even goofier why it's not available in English. But maybe you can correct me and say there is some kind of translation somehow. So, yeah, why don't I like these comics here? Not as much as the other six before. It's maybe because the pacing is sometimes a bit off, and it doesn't flow so seamless. All the facts, the documentation, and the story is sometimes a bit too clunky, how they interact with each other. So you can feel sometimes it's a bit of an essay in this comic here, or yeah, in particular with the first Kaiser, the first emperor. It's yeah, it's you have a lot of pages to wait until the real story really kicked in, and it was just for the last third of the story. So bit off pacing, but just in comparison to the comics before. If these were just the only January Jones comics that I know of, I would praise them in the highest tones, but just you can really feel the absence of Martin Lodewijk. This is a little short Christmas strip, which makes you hope that Eric Heuvel would do more of these bigger panels, because he really makes use of the bigger panels when he can, and the coloring here really is beautiful, even though it is a bit dark. But looks great. But that was just a short story, and here we have so far the last story. January Jones, Rick meeting Mao Zedong and Chiang Kai-shek in China, heroin for Hanoi. And Vietnam, of course. China and Vietnam. And I really can't add more to my assessment that these stories are pretty great. But if you want to start with January Jones, I really would recommend to start in the beginning. And volume one of these collections, and then go to volume two. And if you are in the English-speaking part of the world, just harass your publishers to look out for January Jones so they can get the rights to translate and print them, because they're really worth it. Thanks for listening and watching. Goodbye.